also with you.
Dear brothers and sisters, we have celebrated yesterday the touching mystery of the passion and death of our Lord. Today, Christ rests in the depths of the earth after having fully fulfilled the will of his Father. But not all has yet been completed. The passion of Christ will be extended to his members until the end of times, when he will come again triumphantly in his everlasting Passover. Every Christian is called to complete in his body what is lacking in the suffering of Christ for the sake of his body, the Church. In this pilgrimage of passion and fulfillment, Mary has the first place. She is the woman of faith and of love, the mother of all the living. The Holy Saturday, rest day of Christ, is the hour of the Mother, in which the whole Church is mystically represented, suffering, hoping, imploring, and loving. She is the only light in a dark world, bright flame in the midst of gloomy hearts, for neither the apostles, nor the disciples, nor the faithful women came to believe that on the third day, the Master had to rise glorious from the dead. In faith and prayer, Mary kept watch, tortured by doubt, tempted by Satan. Alone she resisted, bearing the burden of supreme participation in the saving mystery of her Son. In obedience to the plan of the Father, from the disobedience of a woman, Eve, came our ruin. From the obedience of a woman, the Virgin Mary, our redemption has been completed. All the expectations of the world and of the humanity become in her soul a powerful cry to call back from the dead her stained Son, the Creator of life. For if Christ has not been raised, faith would have been useless and human existence would have been meaningless. In this great Saturday, the faith of the whole Church and the hope of all creatures reside in the Mother's heart. She is Church, believing against evidence, hoping against hope, loving until the supreme Holocaust. In order to be able to live with Mary in this hour of faith, let us humbly ask God to cleanse our sins in the blood of Christ and revive our hope in the redemption that had been graciously given us.
Father, mercy.
Wisdom and mercy, you also love the humanity that it was brought to share in your eternal design of salvation. Make us live with Mary, the vital strength of our faith, through which we become your children in baptism, so that with her we may await the dawn of the resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Was remembered by attentive opponents who put guards in front of the tomb. You alone is so late hidden down. You alone for ignoring the come back from the lakes of the dead. You lay new hope of eternity. All believers, you are the great mother. Right path of the church to the heavens.
Alternates to Psalm 118 and short songs called Truparia. The psalm expresses the obedience without conditions of the son and of the mother to the salvific will of the father. Promises, prefigurativeness, prophecies have their fulfillment in the emulation of Christ and the ecclesial extension in the sorrow of the mother. The troparia manifests the will of Mary and of the pious women, pronounced at the sepulchre of Christ, weeping for the pierced firstborn.
How happy those of blameless life who walk in the law of the Lord. How happy those who respect his decrees and seek him with their whole heart.
Looking at the bloodless sacrifice lamb, the pure and wounded ewe was mourning, dragging the onlookers to sad mourning.
Oh, may my behavior be constant in keeping your statutes. If I concentrated on your every commandments, I can never be put to shame.
Mountains and valleys, and you, sons of man, creatures of the cosmos, loudly weep. Mourn with me, the sorrowful Mother of God.
I have treasured your promises in my heart, since I have no wish to sin against you. How blessed are you, O Lord! Teach me your statutes.
The entire world is disturbed and upset. With you, creation is subjected to suffering. O Word holding and containing all things,
I mean to meditate on your precepts and concentrate on your path. I find my delight in your statutes. I do not forget your word.
Among all women, I alone did not know the birth pain, O my God, but now my soul is pregnant of sorrows.
Be good to your servant, and I shall live. I shall observe your word. Open my eyes, I shall concentrate on the marvels of your law.
Groans and tears were shedding, O Lord. The Holy Mother, and tormented, was saying, how will I bury your body, O my son?
Through princes put me on trial, your servant will meditate on your statutes. Since you decrees are my delight, your statutes are my counselors.
Word of the Father, my life, my peace, how can I think of you? 3 days in a tomb, I'm tortured and pierced to the bottom.
Explain to me how to keep your precepts, that I may meditate on your marvels. I am sleepless with grief. Raise me as your word has guaranteed.
Who will give me a fountain of tears, so that I may weep my son day and night? Mourns the Virgin, the bride of the Almighty.
Down in the dust I lie prostrate. Revive me as your word has guaranteed. I admitted my behavior. You answered me. Now teach me your statutes.
O life, will you die? Will you dwell in a tomb? You who destroyed the power of death, and from Hades the dead were called to life.
Turn me from the path of illusion. Grant me the grace of your law. I have chosen the way of fidelity. I have set my heart on your rulings.
Jesus, my joy, my cherished bright light, why were you put in the dark of a grave? O mysterious, O splendid humility of God.
Guide me in the path of your commandments, since my delight is there. I shall proclaim your decrees to kings without fear of disgrace.
Blazing torch now hidden underground, resplendent flesh of Christ in the Hades, light of life dispersing the darkness.
Endlessly the arrogant have jeered at me, but I have not swerved from your law. Remembering your rulings in the past, O Lord, I take comfort.
Jesus, my God and King of the universe, Why are you going in the reign of the dead? You want to save the stock of old Adam.
All night, O Lord, I remember your name and observe your law. Surely it will count to you my credit that I respect your presence.
God asked Abraham to offer in Holocaust his only son. What Abraham did was an expression of pure intention, but Mary did it in reality by lovingly consenting to the immolation of the victim which was born of her.
The first reading is taken from the book of Genesis. After these things, God tested Abraham and said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah, and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. And he cut the wood for the burnt offering, and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. On the third day, Abraham lifted up his eyes and saw the place from afar. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. I and the boy will go over there and worship and come again to you." And Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son. And he took in his hand the fire and the knife. So they went both of them together. And Isaac said to his father Abraham, "My father," and he said, "Here I am, my son." He said, "Behold the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for a burnt offering?" Abraham said, "God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering, my son." So they went both of them together. When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built the altar there and laid the wood in order and bound Isaac, his son, and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, "Abraham, Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Do not lay your hand on the boy and do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me." And Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by his horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called the name of that place, "The Lord will provide," as it is said to this day, "On the mount of the Lord it shall be provided." And the angel of the Lord called to Abraham a second time from heaven and said, "By myself I have sworn, declares the Lord, because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you, and I will surely multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and as the sand that is on the seashore. And your offspring shall possess the gate of his enemies, and in your offspring shall all the nations of the earth be blessed." because you have obeyed my voice. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Blessed Virgin Mary, sharing the redemptive work of Jesus, was obedient to the will of the Father.
She became a cause of salvation for herself and all people.
What Eve had bound by the lack of faith, Mary set free by total faith.
She became a cause of salvation for herself and all people. Celebration alternating to Psalm 118 and Troparia. The psalm tells us that the obedience until death on the cross leads to the glory. The Troparia, full of hope, foretells and urges the resurrection of Christ. The Mother, in the name of the whole Church, is waiting anxiously and joyously the impending Easter.
Lord, make my maker, my preserver. Explain your commandments for me to learn. Seeing me, those who fear you will be glad. since I put my hope in your word.
Looking at your dead body, O Lord, the pure and weeping mother exclaimed, "Don't linger among the dead, my life.
Treat me tenderly and I shall live, since your law is my delight. Shame seizes the arrogant who defame me when I meditate on your precepts."
Joseph of Arimathea took you out of the cross, laying you down, O Lord, in his new sepulcher. Raise up, O Lord, come and save me.
Keeping my hope in your word, I have worn myself out waiting for you to save, and have strained my eyes waiting for your promise. When I want to know, will you console me?
New is the sepulcher you are laid down, to rescue with power our nature decayed, raised from the dead in a true godly way.
The arrogant have dug pitfalls for me in defiance of your law. Your commandments epitomize faithfulness. When liars hound me, you must help me.
Incorrupted, come out from Hades, my life. You living, you walked along the roads of the dead. Break open the seals of the enclosure of hell.
Though these riches have almost done for me, I have never abandoned your precepts. Lovingly intervene, give me life, and I will observe your decrees.
O Lord, you hide yourself underground, and you are covered with a deadly night, but as gloriously as a sun, you reappear.
Lord, though my suffering is acute, revive me as your word has guaranteed. Lord, accept the homage that I offer. Teach me your rulings.
Though you're enclosed in a narrow, dark tomb, all creation, O Jesus, is proclaiming you King, here below and in the heavenly heights.
Away from me, you wicked people. I will respect the commandments of my God. Support me as you have promised, and I shall live. Do not disappoint me of my hope.
When will I finally rejoice in you again, you eternal life, you sweet of my heart, loudly implores the Mother of God.
Treat your servant kindly. Teach me your statutes. My eyes stream with tears because others disregard your law.
Willingly accepting to remain in a tomb, you will awake from their sleep the mortals of old, and gladly will be heard the resounding of your word.
Zeal for your house devours me, since my oppressors forget your word. But your promise is well tested, and your servant holds it dear.
Hidden seed in a fruitful land, you will bring abundant the harvest, raising from death your sorrowful children.
Sincere is my call, Lord, answer me. I will respect your statutes. I invoke your mercy, save me. I will observe your decrees.
The eyes of the mother, in a stream of sad tears, look at the tomb prepared for you. She cries, "Praise, O my son, for you have foretold it."
Universal peace for those who love your law, no stumbling block for them. Waiting for you, Lord, my Savior, I fulfill your commandments.
Come soon, O Lord, to the living your friends, and soothe the pains of the sorrowful mother. She is waiting for you. Come soon, O my Lord.
Lord, may my cry approach your presence. Let your word endow me with perception. May my entreaty reach your presence. Rescue me as you have promised.
Don't cry anymore the death of your son. O faithful mother, I'll be alive for eternity. With power and splendor, I will abandon the dead. I will bring to the stars to glory resplendent, whoever will sing you with faith and sweet love.
The mother at the foot of the cross, the deposition and burial of Christ is the topic of John's Gospel. It is the prelude of the Passover. The Lord will rise from a new sepulchre, leaving it intact in the way he was born from the mother's womb.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Saint John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
But standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her to his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, to fulfill the scripture, "A jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, and so that the bodies would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath was a high day, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, but one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scriptures might be fulfilled, 'No one of his bones will be broken.' And again, another scripture says, 'They will look on him whom they have pierced.' After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him permission. So he came and took away his body. Nicodemus also, who earlier had come to Jesus by night, came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds in weight. So they took the body of Jesus and bound it in a linen cloth with the spices, as is the burial custom of the Jews. Now in the place where he was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been laid. So because of the Jewish day of preparation, since the tomb was close at hand, they laid Jesus there." My dear brothers and sisters, the Holy Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. O Virgin Mary, God made you the companion of the new Adam, and in you the sin of Eve is overcome.
Together with Christ, you battled the enemy, and more than all others, you shared his victory.
Hail, Mother of Christ, hail, Queen over us and all the world.
Together with Christ, you battled the enemy, and more than all others, you shared this victory.
My dear brothers and sisters, today we gather in the presence of the Lord to reflect upon the profound significance of Our Lady of Sorrows, particularly within the rich tradition of the Order of the Servants of Mary. As servites, we are intimately acquainted with the devotion to the seven sorrows of Our Lady, which lies at the very heart of our spirituality. Let us delve into this tradition and glean wisdom and inspiration for our spiritual journey. The servite tradition places a special emphasis on the sorrows of the Blessed Virgin Mary, seeing in her suffering a mirror of Christ's own passion and a profound expression of maternal love for humanity. Our Lady of Sorrows, as depicted in the iconography of the Servite Order, stands as a poignant reminder of the price of redemption and the depth of God's love for us. At the heart of the Servite devotion to Our Lady of Sorrows lies the seven sorrows of Mary, which serve as focal points for meditation and prayer. These sorrows include the prophecy of Simeon, the flight into Egypt, the loss of the child Jesus in the temple, the meeting of Jesus and Mary on the road to Calvary, the crucifixion and death of Jesus, the descent from the cross, and the burial of Jesus. Each of these sorrows, as reflected upon in the Servite tradition, invites us to enter more deeply into the mystery of Christ's passion and to unite our own sufferings with those of Mary and her Son. In contemplating the sorrows of Our Lady, we are reminded of the reality of human suffering and the urgency of our need for redemption. The Servite devotion to Our Lady of Sorrows is not merely a call to lamentation, but a summon to conversion and discipleship. In embracing the sorrows of Mary, we are invited to follow her example of fidelity, humility, and self-offering. Like Mary, we are called to embrace the cross of Christ and to bear witness to the redemptive power of love in the world. In the Servite tradition, Our Lady of Sorrows is also venerated under the title of Mother of Sorrows or Our Lady of Compassion. This title speaks to Mary's role as a compassionate mother who accompanies us in our sorrows and intercedes for us with her Son. In times of trials and tribulations, we can turn to Our Lady of Sorrows with confidence, knowing that she understands our pain and shares in our sufferings. As servites, let us deepen our devotion to Our Lady of Sorrows and allow her to lead us closer to her Son. May her example of faith, courage, and love inspire us to embrace the cross of Christ and to become instruments of his mercy and compassion in the world. Certainly, let us delve deeper into the significance of seven sorrows of Our Lady within the Servite tradition. The first sorrow, the prophecy of Simeon, reminds us of the universal nature of Christ's mission and the role that Mary plays in the salvation of humanity. Through her fiat, her yes to God's plan, Mary becomes intimately united with the redemptive work of her Son. As servites, we are called to emulate Mary's openness to God's will, trusting in his providence, even in the midst of uncertainty and suffering. The second sorrow, the flight into Egypt, speaks to the experience of displacement and exile faced by many in our world today. Mary, Joseph, and the infant Jesus fled to Egypt to escape the violence of Herod, becoming refugees in a foreign land. In this sorrow, we are reminded of the need to welcome and care for the stranger, recognizing the inherent dignity of every human person as a child of God. The third sorrow, the loss of the child Jesus in the temple, reveals Mary's deep sense of maternal concern and anxiety for her son. This sorrow invites us to reflect on the importance of family life and the responsibility we have to nurture and protect our loved ones. Like Mary, we are called to entrust our families to God's loving care and to seek His guidance in all things. The fourth sorrow, the meeting of Jesus and Mary on the road to Calvary, portrays the agonizing journey that Mary undertakes as she accompanies her son to his crucifixion. In this sorrow, we see Mary's unwavering faith and courage in the face of unimaginable suffering. As servants, we are called to walk with Mary on the road to Calvary, offering our prayers and sacrifices in solidarity with all who bear the cross of Christ. The fifth sorrow, the crucifixion and death of Jesus, is the culmination of Mary's sorrows and the ultimate expression of God's love for humanity. As servants, we contemplate the crucified Christ with Mary at the foot of the cross, acknowledging our own complicity in His suffering through our sins. Yet we also find hope in the promise of redemption and the victory of love over sin and death. The sixth sorrow, Mary receives the body of Jesus taken down from the cross. The Pietà image reveals Mary's tender love and compassion as she receives the lifeless body of her son into her arms. In this sorrow, we are reminded of Mary's role as the Mother of Mercy, who offers comfort and solace to all who are grieving. As servants, we turn to Mary in times of sorrow, trusting in her maternal care and intercession. The seventh sorrow, the burial of Jesus and the awaiting of the resurrection, marks the end of Christ's earthly life and the beginning of His triumph over sin and death. In this sorrow, we find consolation in the hope of the resurrection and the promise of eternal life. As servants, we entrust ourselves to Mary's prayers as we await the fulfillment of God's kingdom, where all tears will be wiped away and death will be no more. Let us deepen our devotion to Our Lady of Sorrows and allow her to accompany us on our journey of faith. May her example of faith, courage, and love inspire us to embrace the cross of Christ and to become instruments of His mercy and compassion in the world. May Our Lady of Sorrows intercede for us and lead us to the joy of eternal life with her Son. In conclusion, let us heed the words of Saint Philip Benizi, one of the early prior generals of the Servite Order, who writes, "Let us venerate the Holy Virgin who bore the sorrows of the cross, and let us honor her with the deepest devotion. May Our Lady of Sorrows accompany us in our journey of faith and lead us to the joy of eternal life with her Son. Amen." After having contemplated the Mother's sorrows and hopes, let us now address to Christ our life with the words of the ancient fathers of the Church, and let us ask Him to pour in us that same heroical faith given to the Mother through the Holy Spirit. O Son of the Virgin, O Virgin's God, O Creator of the universe, yours is the passion, yours the wisdom's depth. You know what you were and what you became. In order to save man, you came in this world and freely accepted the shameful passion. You put on your shoulders our faults. As a lamb, you destroyed our sins. O Redeemer, with your death and all were saved. As a man, it's you who suffer. As God, you're unmoved. You who are dying and saving, you who gave the mother the courage to exclaim, O my Son and my God.
Mary's side and prayer.
Lord.